It starts small. Just a few news reports about a strange virus in a distant country. Then it gets uncomfortable. A handful of cases have shown up in the United States. But these things usually burn themselves out. That's what you tell yourself. And then, all of a sudden, everything changes. A pandemic brings America to a standstill. We all know this story from the recent past, but here's the troubling reality. It also might be a story from the not-too-distant future. This time, though, there's one key difference. This time, we might be able to stop it. In an age of polarization, here's one thing pretty much everyone agrees on. We're never doing 2020 again. Zero stars, would not recommend. But let's face it, we were all so desperate to put the COVID pandemic behind us that from the second we chucked our masks into the trash, most of us did our level best to never think about it again. Which means we've probably forgotten the scope of what exactly happened to us. By the third anniversary of the pandemic, the United States had recorded 103 million cases of COVID. Over 1.1 million Americans had died from the disease. And worldwide, that number had reached over 6.8 million. And as awful as that was, it paled in comparison to what previous generations faced. The bubonic plague is estimated to have killed around 200 million people in the 14th century. And sure, that seems like ancient history, but it was only about a century ago that the Spanish flu killed 50 million. And this underscores an important point. Pandemics are a recurring feature of human history, and actually more common than we might think. In fact, there are regularly 3 to 4 pandemics per century that kill over a million people. A 2023 paper in the journal Nature estimated that the odds of another pandemic in our lifetimes is at least 17%, and given the increase in outbreaks of new diseases, may even rise as high as 44%. Basically a coin flip. All of which means we should be doing everything in our power to get ahead of the next one. If only so we don't have to endure this again.
Imagine all the people
living for today.
She's not done.
Yeah.
So, what can we do to keep a scenario like 2020 from repeating? Luckily, scholars who study this question have a lot of ideas. One of the best places to start would be figuring out who's responsible for monitoring disease outbreaks before they turn into a full-blown crisis. Right now, the answer to that question involves some entities you might expect: the White House, the CDC, the Department of Health and Human Services. But it also involves about 20 others, like the Department of Commerce and the Department of Labor, and the Postal Service. Because when you think of efficient tracking, you think of the Postal Service. Beyond the question of who monitors these outbreaks, there's also the question of how to do it. And on that front, we learned a valuable lesson during COVID. A valuable and disgusting lesson. It turns out that monitoring wastewater, which is exactly what it sounds like, is an incredibly efficient way to track the spread of disease. While this technique has been used for decades to keep tabs on diseases like polio, it only got adopted for COVID midway through the pandemic, with some impressive results. In San Francisco, for instance, wastewater monitoring actually detected the Omicron variant of COVID even before local doctors did. But even though this method allows us to see new developments even before people start feeling sick, America hasn't yet made it a permanent nationwide program. Real progress, of course, would go beyond just getting faster, better data on how sick we are. Real progress would be keeping us from getting sick in the first place. And on that front, there are some potential breakthroughs on the horizon. Now, trying to plan ahead for any virus that Mother Nature might throw at us might seem borderline impossible. And after all, it's estimated that there are probably about 600,000 of them. But here's where things get interesting. The viruses that affect humans all fall into a relatively small number of virus families, a number usually pegged at around 26, though new technology will probably identify more. That's still a lot, but it gives us a clearer map of where future threats might come from. And that means that targeting the commonalities across diseases could lead to some real medical innovations. Scientists are currently at work, for instance, on what are known as broad-spectrum antiviral drugs, treatments that could be deployed immediately in the wake of an outbreak because they could effectively treat a wide variety of infections without having to be tailored to whichever specific virus we're fighting. And while effective antivirals of this kind would be a huge step forward, they'd still be a distant second to snuffing out these diseases from the start. And on that front, there's some promising news. Because of the limited number of virus families we're worried about, we could start working on treatments in advance. The White House Office of Science and Technology Policy has estimated that having prototype vaccines ready to go for all 26 of them could be accomplished for $24 billion, which might seem like a lot of money, but consider that COVID's total cost to the American economy has been estimated at somewhere around $14 trillion. Now, you might be thinking, yeah, but how helpful is that when vaccines have become one of the most controversial issues in America? But there's good news there, too. By developing these immunizations in advance, we'd also be able to test their safety and effectiveness in advance. And as a result, they'd be available to be rolled out within 100 days of the virus being identified. All of which should be cause for optimism, but not complacency. Because these technologies might be promising, but that doesn't necessarily mean they're a priority. There's a worrisome history of ignoring long-term threats like these until it's too late. In the aftermath of 9/11, for example, the federal government created a program to help hospitals prepare for crises like a pandemic. While the program got $515 million in 2004, its funding steadily declined in the following years, apart from a few increases after dangerous viruses emerged. By the time COVID came around, it had declined over 46% from the post-9/11 high, which is one more lesson from COVID. There are only two kinds of pandemic preparedness, early or too late. Let's hope the next time we get it right. If only to avoid more of this.
No need for greed and hunger, brotherhood of man.